it's time for us to start, but I hear that there were some slow lines at lunch, so perhaps we get folks coming in and I can go back and review anything or cover anything later. Thanks for joining Advanced William Caps for Apple TV. Today we're going to be talking about this clunky device right here, but it doesn't really matter that it's that clunky because you'll put it under your TV and kind of forget about it. And this really kind of spelt device here, the Apple TV remote, which they both introduced last year. Did anybody attend the Apple TV development presentation I did at this conference last year? Go ahead and repeat. Has anybody prepared their own Apple TV app in here? You got a couple people? Okay, great. All right. So, welcome your feedback or any additional thoughts you got. I'm going to jump right in since this is advanced app development. I'm going to jump right in to kind of right after last year's presentation, assuming we've got a baseline Apple TV understanding. But if you got some questions, we have a pretty small group, so just ask me and then. I'm going to post the updated GitHub repository from last year, so I've updated it for the latest Xcode, and so you'll get both links, this year's GitHub repository and last year's, so if you want to go back and look at any of that code, you're welcome to. All right, so a little bit about me. My name is Justin Dominance. I went to Georgia Tech, so I just had an MBA from Georgia State, and until recently I lived in Atlanta, now I live in Miami. Here for the nice, dry air. It's been a long time since I've been somewhere with this low humidity. Right now, I do independent contracting, but most of my career I've spent developing software in the retail and food service space. So everything in this presentation today is going to be using Xcode 9 Beta 5 and iOS 11 and tvOS 11. You don't need to frantically type anything while I'm giving the presentation. Every single bit of code I'm going to show you today will be on the GitHub repository now that I've got a Slack or a Slack link. I'll be able to post that after this session so everybody can download it. We're going to go through a few things, a couple conceptual things, but a lot of it I'm going to show you code and simulators and running the code. We're going to talk about extending your iOS application to an Apple TV application. We're going to talk about disk storage and CloudKit and how you share things between an iOS application and an Apple TV application. The user experience on the Apple TV is obviously different because the user isn't touching the screen. They're using this remote here to do everything. And then I'll have a link to some of the resources to get on the repository and some other things that I found along the way. Please do ask me any questions along the way as we go through this. Okay, so in iOS applications, or in tvOS applications, we can use an enormous subset of the already existing iOS framework, but it is a subset. But given that we can use that subset, we can share a lot of code between the two. So if you've already got an iOS application and you're extending it, this is the approach to take go through. NIMS can't be directly shared, so you've got a really nice view you build for a cell that you build for a table that you want to just plug into your Apple TV app. You can't do it directly, but I'm going to show you a shortcut, a little bit of a hack, but a shortcut to kind of get started and move over to tvOS if you've got on the additional views. So let's look at some code and kind of see how I might share some things between tvOS and iOS. I've got the iPhone 6S simulator going here as well as the Apple TV 1080p simulator. And what we're going to do is I'm just going to start up a iOS application I built here and take a look at that. Presentation, you may make it into the presentation. Please say nice things. And then Over here, we have a profile tab. So I have an image downloaded from iCloud that when the user can set their profile, maybe your maybe something one of your apps already has, where they can choose a photo from the photo library, upload that, and then you've got a nice profile image wherever they go that they can use, and kind of makes it a very personalized experience. So you might have an iOS application that looks a little bit like this, and then you want to move it over to tvOS. Well, thankfully, there's a lot of things about that that are easy and a few things that are tricky. First thing is that if it's a class that's shared between iOS and tvOS, all you have to do is just make sure it's part of both targets in your project. So here I've got an iOS app that you've already taken a look at, and then that's my target here. A tvOS target here, and then I've extended the CK asset. I've done this for some of the cog kits that we're going to look at in a little bit. And all I've done is just made sure that both the tvOS and the iOS extension, or sorry, targets are both using that class on that extension. So if we look through here, as you're looking at your iOS application and thinking, what can I move over to tvOS? Hopefully, you've got an architected model or you've got some utility classes, and then it's just a matter of making sure that you don't have anything in those that won't natively run on the tvOS platform, and then just checking that box in your project. So what I've got is I've got an extension here, I've got a utilities class, which does all of my CloudKit stuff. This is just, I've got some static methods that I can call from either iOS or tvOS. And I've got all my Twitter stuff in here, the interface which makes the network calls. I zoomed in here so that we can have a nice view on the big screen, but obviously I probably wouldn't have it this large when I could develop it. Media item, Twitter, the tweet user. These are all data structures that my tweet interface uses to load the tweet, build the tweet. And then I even have a couple of things that are more user interface related, which is I have my settings view controller. I only have one of those between both my tvOS app and my iOS app. And I have a tweet table view sum, which I'm using in both. So these are things that are tied directly to user interface elements, but because both iOS and tvOS use them, I can actually share these between the two targets without having to recreate them. Now this is, there's a couple little funny things about this. One is the settings view controller, which is used in both places. We'll take a look at the tvOS application now. For some reason, Xcode, because I have a version of the home view controller for both tvOS and iOS, for some reason it doesn't know what it is here. And I think it's either a bug with the beta or, you know, maybe it's just is confused by the ambiguity. But this works fine, even though we're getting what looks like a compiler. And then as far as the tweet table you sell, I'm going to show you how we can start with a nib and then share it over with the tvOS application. So let's look at the tvOS application and start that up. And I can have both running at the same time. I'm just going to choose the tvOS scheme, target, and run that.
Just running both of those at the same time that Xcode
9 feature? No, you can do that prior to Xcode 9. But they made significant improvements to the simulator in Xcode 9. For example, you used to have kind of two different windows down here for each simulator that was running. You'd have a little icon for the TV simulator and an icon for the iPhone simulator. But now they've unified all that into one application. And then over here, you get a list of all the different simulators you have running simultaneously. For TV, this is novel. I'm going to jump ahead of myself to Wednesday. I'm presenting on advanced apps for Apple Watch on Wednesday, and this is really helpful for the Apple Watch, but it's not helpful for the TV. Now we've got the application here, and I've essentially replicated all the functionality. I've got the home view controller with my Twitter feed. I've got a profile tab that's downloading my profile image from iCloud. And then I've got a settings tab where I can change the hashtag that I'm searching on. So let me show you how to change, reuse a nib from one place to the other, and then I can foster some questions if you guys have got any thrown at me, whatever. Let's say that I've got this nib under the iOS part of my project, which is right here. And I've already created one just for, to save us a little bit of time, called Share Demo. And all this is a nib that has a view and a check mark in the center, nothing fancy. And I look over at the properties of this. I want to include this in my TeamUS project. So let's stop the TeamUS application and let's build it again. And I'll get an error saying, hey, this nib is designed for iOS. It can't be used in your TV. So what do we do now? Well, what I can do is I can go over here into my TeamUS application. I can create a new nib. And if you haven't done TeamUS development before, just remember you've got a whole different tab over here. So we've got iOS, watchOS, and then TeamUS over here. So you want to go there and create your classes for TeamUS. Create a view. We'll call this the same thing. We'll call this, what do you call the other one? Share demo. Okay, and all I'm going to do is I'm just going to hack this a little bit. I'm going to open it as source code. I'm going to open the other ones as source code. I found this useful, so I'm going to show you guys. Okay, here's the one where I've already got all the stuff I did to it. Now, in my case, I only did a little bit, so this isn't saving me a lot of time. It lets you do a lot of stuff in your view, and you want to start from there instead of building from scratch with TeamUS. And we're just going to go back over to our other end. And I'm just going to replace everything in the objects tabs. And let's open it in Interface Builder. It'll give me a little bit of a warning saying, hey, something wasn't quite right, but then it fixed it right up for me. So imagine you've done a lot of stuff in your iOS app today, you've already got it, you want to quickly just plug that over. It's not all going to be built our TeamUS application. What else can we share between? What else can we share between TeamUS and iOS? Well, over the last few years with CloudKit, Apple's given us some tools to share things across. Not only is people that are running in the same iOS application, maybe on an iPad or an iPhone or across devices. But also now we can share things between an iOS device and an Apple TV device. And we're given a couple of ways to do that. One is called iCloud Key Value Storage, so KVS for short. And what this does is allows us to basically store things like user preferences in the cloud and pull them down from anywhere and also get notifications when they change on one device so we can update the other device. We also have access to CloudKit, which does something similar conceptually, but in a totally, totally different way. It's using iCloud to store more of like a proper data model structure and records, and then we can store bigger files and bigger records there. So I'm going to show you both of those things in the context of iOS and TeamUS so we can share data back and forth. User defaults on the Apple TV, if you're only writing an Apple TV app and you don't care about an iOS app, then those work exactly the same. You don't have to worry about learning something new. You can store those all day on TeamUS. I do have a bullet point at the bottom here. You might see our on-demand resources. We'll talk about that in just a minute, but we're not going to actually do that today. Europe, it's gotten better, where you can allow your user to download your app, install the app, start running the app, and then download significant resources later. So imagine a role-playing game where you're having the user set up your character's name and what their avatar looks like. You can do all that, and then go download all the video files and sound files and graphic files and background after they've installed the app, which is pretty neat that all this is coming from Apple services. So if that's something your application might take advantage of, and do look up the ODR for that feature. Okay? So what we're going to do is we're going to start with the KBS, and we're going to talk about how to set it up. And the first thing I'm going to do, and up until I started working with TUS and CloudKit, I don't think I had ever signed into iCloud on the simulator. And I don't know, at one point they introduced this, but I've been a while back. Does anybody know when they introduced this on the simulators? I don't know if you could even do this that long ago. But what I'm going to do is I'm just going to make sure I'm signed into the iCloud on the simulators. So you want to start there. Make sure that you have a dummy account. In this case, it's actually my real personal account on both the simulators. Let's look at then, we're going to look at the setup of the two targets, the two projects. So looking at the TVOS setup here under capabilities, I've got a key value storage set and CloudKit storage. Oh, sorry, I'm not checking that. Key value storage and CloudKit setup for TVOS. And I've got key value storage and CloudKit setup for iOS as well. Now I could check iCloud documents, but that's not supported with TUS, so that wouldn't apply to what we're talking about today. Then I've got to make sure, and this is key, you can see from my naming convention here that I actually iterate on this a little bit to get it to working. But iCloud.com.logio.idev2017.1, that has to be the same on both of these, in order for them to share KBS and cloud resources. Then you'll want to also make sure that both on the iOS application and on the TUS application, you've got background fetch and remote notifications enabled for both. What this allows us to do is get notifications if the key value storage has changed on another device, and then respond to that by updating our local settings. I want to make sure I did everything in line. Talk about a container. Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about this file manager ubiquity token. If you haven't done anything with KBS and you go home and start trying to do this on your own, you're going to come across this a lot, this idea of basically getting a ubiquity identity token to share data across devices. It comes up in all of Apple's documentation, but it doesn't apply at all to TVOS. And it's very ambiguous about that in the documentation. We're going to use a different API call to do KBS stuff on both iOS and on TVOS, and this is something only on the iOS side. Also, if you are doing an Apple Watch app as part of your suite of applications you're doing, KBS is not available on Apple Watch, so any of your settings that your users set using that on the TV or on your iPhone won't automatically push, can't be pushed automatically. So let's look at some more code. So in order to grab the KBS, I'm going to go into the app delegate. We'll go in the app delegate on the Apple TV. And what I've done is I've written just a simple helper method, KBS setup, which runs and didn't finish launching. And this is pretty simple now. I'm just going to do two things. I'm going to add an observer so that I get the notification that key values changed on my other application, any other devices out there, and then I'm just going to synchronize my local application with the ubiquitous key value storage store so that I'm going to get all the latest stuff pushed to me right away immediately. And if I do get any changes or any stuff from KBS, then I'm going to just update my local user preferences to have that. And in this case, I'm storing the hashtag between me So we have that on the TPOS, and I also put that in the app delegate on the iOS application. So let's see what happens. I'm going to go to my iOS application. And we'll go here. Let's change the hashtag to the Rockies. They're playing the Atlanta Braves tonight, which used to be my team in Atlanta. Okay, so now we've got the Rockies here in our Twitter feed, and let's go ahead and launch. This synchronization via background pushes will happen on the simulators, but it's not real time. Maybe take a minute or two. So just for expediency, I'm just going to restart the TPOS application. So let's move on to the cloud stuff there. Not exactly how I'm sharing stuff between the two devices on the cloud. If you haven't taken a look at the CloudKit dashboard, this is what it looks like here. So what you've got is actually this is pretty neat. Just like you might have a local database server or core data on your device, we can actually look at all the records that are being stored online by users yourself using the cloud between the two devices. So I've created this profile here, and it's got Daenerys Targaryen, and it's got the photo, which is where the profile image is being downloaded from both devices. So the user uploads a new photo, everywhere you go, it's downloading a new photo, which is really nice user experience. So what's the code that supports that? Let's take a look. And here I'm using a shared CloudKit Utils class that I created, and what I've got is I've got a fetch profile photo, which goes and builds a predicate kind of similar to if you've done any core data work, how you would do the query, goes to the private DB, which is defined up here in my container, private cloud database, which means that other users wouldn't be able to see this. It's only this particular user that gets to see this. And then there's the CloudKit setup stuff here, which essentially you can look at this in detail on the GitHub repository. basically says, hey, I'm interested in cloud-based data. I'm going to register for changes. Please let me know and allow me to read and write. So this is a nice shared library between the two iOS applications and the tvOS application that lets me share this data back and forth. Okay, so before we go on to the user experience and the specific things about being on the Apple TV, do you have any questions about sharing code between your iOS and TV application or sharing data in the cloud, whether it's KBS or
stuff. So do we have multiple configuration profiles, configurations for SDK that you've created, and you have multiple SDKs? How do you handle load when it comes to having multiple targets shared between your iOS application and others?
Okay, so I understand. So basically, you're wanting to support like iOS 9 on the.
Mainly, if you have to have a target for every single platform.
Right.
So if you have a framework and you have a main application, you have to have a target for both iOS and for tvOS for every single basically compiled group event. So if you had a framework, then that would require two targets being for tvOS and iOS. If you had another framework, that would be two more. And if you had iOS shared across the two, that would be two for your main project, which can stack up pretty quickly.
Right.
I've had projects with four internally built frameworks and we support three platforms. So you've got four times three just for targets.
Yeah.
And it can become a bit cumbersome over time. So I wasn't sure if you ran into a similar issue before.
It's a good point, and I don't have any great solution for that. I have run into that same issue. So, for example, I have a framework that I use for authentication with the client that I'm working with, and it ties authentication into a view controller, and you don't have view controllers on the watchOS, for example. So I can't use that framework. I have to build essentially a whole different authentication framework just for the watch because the two architectures can't use the same framework. That's the problem I'm talking about.
More of how many different targets you have to have
for everything,
because Xcode, I think if you hit around somewhere above 30 targets inside your application, Xcode quite literally freaks out and doesn't handle it at all. So if you build a watch tvOS and iOS application and you have multiple frameworks being five, you're hitting close to that exact limit where Xcode can't.
I haven't hit. I mean, you're definitely pushing limits. I haven't hit that high of a limit before personally. But the frameworks are just, for very smart people, they're just a pain. I mean, they're just like, you gotta support all the architectures, or you have one for each architecture, and then if you got code in there. I don't have any great silver bullets for how to improve that with tvOS.
So my other question would be the more likely scenario. If you already have an iOS application, potentially a watchOS, you're likely to use Core Data. Have you ran into any persisting issues with Core Data on tvOS, specifically because of that memory size limit and automatic write that feature?
Yeah. I haven't, but the Core Data stuff that I'm doing is pretty small stuff. It's just it's such a bit larger, it needs more structure than user preferences for me. And so that's why I'm really interested in hiring a cloud kit, because then if you're connected. If you're not connected, then that's a different story. But if you're connected, then you could have all that in the cloud kit, and you could have files because you want, and they're just not managed.
Yeah, I think the primary issue is in enterprise environments. It's usually not the good.
Yeah.
And separation, having control of the networking layer, and your model layer, and with the known issues of cloud kit. My company's prepping to potentially build a TV. That's why, and we have a dedicated framework for persistence
you know, as far as them clearing out the data, there is a lower limit. I think you got some protection there.
I think it was like 500.
Yeah. So if you're beyond that, you got a lot of data in your data, and so that might be an issue there.
Images.
Yeah. So, well, good questions, but no, I mean, good things to work through, but I don't have any immediate solutions for any of that other than, you know, and plus, TDoS is fairly nascent still. Maybe a year and a half into it. So things will change, and then hopefully it'll be better. But it's still pretty new.
I'm hoping with 4K support that they start up a local storage tool.
Any other questions? Good. So on iOS 11, or I should say TDoS 11, we've got a couple improvements with safe areas and how they handle the size of the TV and the overscan. I'm just making a note here, I don't have any code examples, but if you are using a whole screen and you need to watch out for things going over the edge of that, these are some good features they added in the latest iteration of TDoS. Let's talk about some cool stuff with focus and images. So we go over here and we got this cool photo of Daenerys here looking like she's ready for battle. And we can actually use the Apple TV remote, and we can tap down and we can actually get focus on that image. And what's even neater for our users, and I'll just show you, I can show the Apple TV remote here, just right next to the simulator. And if our users are scrolling around on the screen and they happen to drag the thumb around on the touchpad on the TV remote, you actually get a nice parallax 3D effect, which is a really nice user experience. It makes the TV go from being a very flat, distant thing to very touchy-feely, kind of a nice experience for your customers. And it's not hard to do that, but you have to do some steps to make that work. Unlike when we go over here to our Twitter feed, and we're showing a UI table view controller here. Each of these cells automatically understands whether the user has focused it or not using the remote. So as I move around the screen using the remote, focus, and you can do some extra animations by doing a sort of effect you want. So now we've got a check mark in the middle of our image, which maybe you want to put on the side or whatever, but let's now move our thumb around the remote. Now, what's interesting about this is that while that check mark is useful, I know I've watched that episode already, it's not moving around with the image. I've got this kind of, you know, above, I've got this kind of floating above there. That's not a great experience for the user. It kind of looks a little disconnected. So in tvOS 11, they introduced this overlay content view. And let's see how it behaves differently if I add my check mark to the overlay content view instead of adding it as a sub view to the image.
Maybe I'll see you guys later.